see your eyes, I see a smile hidden in the dark. I see your soul leaving a mark. You gotta tell yourself life. You gotta tell yourself you still have a fight. 'Cause everything's gonna be changing. You'll be howling at the moon, and everything's gonna be changing. The flowers in bloom. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Mm-hmm. I know you see no escape from these words. You gotta retrace your steps, be the better man, be the best. You gotta tell yourself you can see the light. You gotta tell yourself you still have to fight. 'Cause everything's gonna be changing. You'll be howling at the moon.
My wife and I bought this vehicle in December of 2012 at a Mecum auction. It was nicely painted, and it had gone through its original restoration from the owner before us, who lived over in Springfield, Missouri. We liked it because it looked exactly like the truck that I learned to drive on as a boy, and it reminded me a lot of my father, who ran a trucking business. We have a set of signs that we also present during shows that are a tribute to my dad, and you'll find them in the brochure that we've made about this vehicle as well. So this vehicle then represents an era of the mid-1940s and has been 100% restored to standard. The initial restoration on it was very nicely done, but when we brought it to Mann's, we learned a lot. These guys did a lot of research for us and helped us find many things that would bring this vehicle up to its 100% restoration class. We've replaced every Phillips head screw that they had used with a slotted screw. They repainted the fender wells because the fender wells would not have been painted black. The original restoration had black fender wells, but they would have been painted the same color of the vehicle, because Henry Ford was a known cheapskate and there was no way he was going to change colors on the inside of those fenders. So they did a beautiful job of restoring this vehicle, including the colors, this color being Tacoma Cream, this color being Greenfield Green, original colors by the Ford Motor Company. And they just worked very, very hard to, both under the engine and throughout the vehicle, bring it up to standard. So we were very lucky to have them involved. And after that, as we began to show the vehicle at Concours and at the early Ford V8 clubs and the AACA, they recognized that this vehicle was 100% to standard. This front end was very practical at the time. these little lights were running lights, but not directional signals. There were no directional signals. The driver owned the directional signals. They were manual and they worked like this. So you had parking lights, headlights, high and low beam, and you had this interesting grill assembly here that was called, with a couple of nicknames. One was the jail bar grill, presuming that this is you and you're behind the bars in jail, and sometimes called the waterfall grill. The grill was continued through 1947, and then after that, Ford completely redesigned the front end of these trucks with the big muscular horizontal pieces in it. Here's an interesting thing about how the hood works. The hood works like this, and there is no security to getting under the hood compartment. Anybody, anywhere can do that. So it's a simple lift here, in with the finger here, and the hood goes right up. The further interesting thing is that there is a key in the vehicle. And the key, one might mistake for an ignition key, but all it really does is lock the steering column. So if you wanted to have this in a secure place, you would crank the wheel all the way to the right, lock the column so that it couldn't turn, take the key out, and someone could start the motor and do anything they want, but they couldn't drive the car off. And this mechanism was all very secure in keeping that from occurring. The other piece of that might be interesting to many people is that the fuel tank, all 19 gallons of it, lives under the seat. So as the owner driver of this vehicle, you are sitting on 19 gallons of fuel, and that's where the fuel was stored. At one point in Ford history, all the fuel was stored up here because they didn't have fuel pumps, and the fuel got to the engine by gravity. But this is a very modern a change when you could put the fuel wherever you wanted to. Later in the 40s, they put the fuel tanks under the bed of the truck. To start the motor, all you had to do was switch the toggle on, which supplies electric to the system. Then push the black button to start, and the motor starts and runs. Has a three-speed transmission. This is the lights, this is the choke, this is the throttle. These are the original keys that were sold at the time the vehicle was made. So they have become part of the provenance of this vehicle. So imagine these keys. You talk about losing your keys at home. Imagine these keys living since 1946 and never getting lost with this vehicle. As a heater, interesting heater system. If your feet are cold, you open that. If your wife's feet are cold, you open that. If the dog is cold, you open that. All three people stay warm in the system. So that's how the heater system worked. There was a fan. If you wanted to defrost, they had a very ingenious thing they did with the fan. You turn the switch, and all it did was reverse the fan, and it pushed air up through the actual defrost slats that you see here. Now, to say that at 11 below zero with the moisture in the air that it would do much, I don't think so, but it was a darn good start. Henry Ford was very smart. He charged $75 for a heater if you wanted. It did not come with the truck. The truck, when delivered new in 1946, cost $1,175 complete. You did not get a spare tire with the truck because the war had just ended and there was still a shortage of rubber. But your dealer told you that when your tire came in, he'd give you a call and you could come down and get your tire. You got the wheel, but you didn't get the tire. And over a few months after the war ended, the rubber production increased and you got the phone call and you got your spare tire. Of course, this is the very revolutionary Ford V8 flathead motor. And it is 239 cubic inches. The valves that allow fuel in and exhaust in are all in the block, and they move up and down into slots in the head. And that is the reason it was called a flathead motor. Here is that oil bath air cleaner that we've chatted about. Generator system. The electrical system is 6-volt positive ground, exactly the way it was made in 1946. Each block is a separate component of itself where coolant runs, and the only time the coolant mixes on this is in the radiator. Otherwise, it's almost like two side-by-side four-cylinder motors. 6-volt positive ground is the electrical system. Here's your voltage regulator, here's your coil, here's a 6-volt generator, and a standard carburetor. And we always say, well, this is more than just a vehicle. This is a little piece of automotive history because it contains a lot of things that happened in 1946 that, you know, to some degree are still being used today. The design of the vehicle was wonderful because it had these large fenders on it. They were large and robust and voluptuous, and a lot of guys that have bought these over the years have immediately taken that flathead V8 out. They've replaced it with something as awful as a 350 Chevy stock block engine or something that disrespectful, and they put gigantic tires and wheels on it. And these fenders accommodate all of that. In the brochure material to sell these, Ford had very carefully designed the box back here because it accommodated a certain number of milk containers, a certain number of livestock containers, all to make it a good utility vehicle on the farm. And it was just that. It was a utility vehicle. There was a pent-up demand for them. These were for the original trucks that were built right after the World War II, so there was a real demand for these kind of things, and they sold a lot of them. Interestingly, the 30 millionth vehicle ever manufactured by the Ford Motor Company was the 1946 Ford pickup truck. Not this one, but its exact duplicate. Another example of these beautiful, round, voluptuous fenders on here. And so, to that extent, they make a wonderful hot rod if somebody's a hot rodder and they want a basic set of bones in order to build on. But then if you want to restore one to standard. The other thing that was interesting by Ford, they designed and built this cab, and it fit on every truck they built, whether it was a big truck or a little truck. This cab can be unbolted with 8 bolts or so, lifted off and put on any other frame of its era. So there were a lot of interesting things going on in the Ford production world about interchangeability of parts and pieces. These are the actual hubcaps that came with it. These are called feathers. The Ford Motor Company called them feathered. Some of them were painted, not all of them. If they were painted, these were painted red. But here's an interesting piece of history with Ford hubcaps. Henry Ford used everything. So if he changed the design of hubcaps on a model, he used the ones that were still on the shelf. So you could have a 46 car without the red feathered hubcaps and it would still be correct because Henry Ford was in fact saying, we're not throwing anything away. So there's a interesting thing. Now, these caps, they all had metal caps on the inner tubes that are in the tire. So that's another area in which you would get points. And these are period correct restoration tires from the Firestone Company because Henry Ford and Mr. Firestone were the best of friends. So he ran around with Harvey Firestone, mm-hmm. Thomas Edison, and himself, and they had a lot of joint ventures together. Most people are unaware of the fact that the early Fords were delivered in a box, a crate, a wooden crate, and that the wooden crate was actually part of the vehicle. So the first warning you would get is do not break up this crate. And all that wood came from the upper peninsula of Michigan, and they took the scraps and they made charcoal out of it, and that is where the charcoal called Kingsford came from. This is a custom toolkit that we have researched, and this would be the exact toolkit that would have been delivered by the Ford Motor Company to the owner of this truck, the new owner. One of the interesting pieces of history is that although you can start this engine with a crank, as an example, Ford never delivered them in the U.S. with a crank because they didn't want the consumer to think that the battery starter system wouldn't work. But any of these vehicles built to be shipped anywhere else in the world included a crank. So as I show you this, there'll be no crank to start the motor. We have found and identified the kit, and these are some of the components that came with it. Here's a universal wrench that would remove spark plugs and other pieces off of it. This is a slotted screwdriver. There were no Phillips head screws in 1946, so the only screws in this would have a slotted surface to them. This is a universal tool that the Ford Motor Company delivered with it. We commonly call them monkey wrenches, and that would have been part of the toolkit. This is a pair of pliers that would have been delivered. This is yet another tool that would have come with the Ford Company. All of these have the Ford trademark in it and would have been Ford tools. This is a sump device, and this is another small wrench. The engine has a oil bath system that's used for air cleaning, and when it came time to change the oil, this is how you would suck the oil out of the air cleaner and deposit it elsewhere rather than to actually try to take the air cleaner off and dump it over and tip it. So that's what this sump is for. So this is the basic toolkit. There was, of course, a jack. This is the jack that would have come with it, and so it's a device that when this crank was installed in it, would fit in there and crank the vehicle up and down. So this is exactly the tire changing tool that would have been part of it. And then sometimes you actually had to remove the tire from the wheel, and this is the levered piece that you would take the tire off of the wheel so that you could put a new tire on the wheel. So this was everything you needed in order to do tire maintenance. So this is the toolkit that would have been delivered by the Ford Motor Company in 1946 when the automobile was made.
I see your eyes, I see a smile hidden in the dark. I see your soul leaving a mark. You gotta tell yourself you can see the light. You gotta tell yourself you still have the fire. Everything's gonna be changing. You'll be howling at the moon. And everything's gonna be changing like the flowers in bloom. Oh, oh, oh.
Not the only one. Oh.